This is a not very rare subject, also odontoid idiomas. And many people I see are mixing it or getting confusion that it is as a result of trauma. So there is also another disease, rheumatoid arthritis, causing instability at the upper cervical spine. It's also quite common. If you see in the late phases of the disease, you can see some rheumatoid arthritis patients as well. There is one rule of thirds, trees. So in the atlas area, one third of the area is occupied by odontoid process, one third is occupied by spinal cord, and one third by CSF. So because of that, without a very significant dislocation, there is no neurologic deficits. So most of the cases in odontoid fractures, we don't see any neurology in most of the cases. What is also odontoidium? It is a round or oval ossicle with smooth circumferential margins and no osseous continuity with the body of axis. It's mostly diagnosed in the first three decades of the life. So in older ages, we don't see it much. Etiology may be congenital or traumatic. Probably traumatic is something that one odontoid fracture happens many years before, and it is not diagnosed properly. And by the time, we assume that it is a congenital disease. Although there are some publications that is trying to differentiate congenital origin also odontoidium from traumatic origin, it does not much give difference. I found one paper that the segmentation defect in the mid odontoid process is the reason of congenital type of osteodontoidium. In the childhood, we can see the so-called subdental synchondrosis if you look at the MR images. But if that synchondrosis is not really ossified, then it may cause some osteodontoidium, congenital type of osteodontoidium. What happens then? Because odontoid process is not connected with the axis body, so there is a significant instability at C1, C2. So it causes, by the time, chronic neurologic symptoms, and sometimes sudden spinal cord injury with minor trauma. And then patients may come to you after a small fall with severe tetraparesis. And then you look at the films and see a rupture of the odontoid. So then you can assume this is because of odontoid fracture. This is a very common scenario I see from my colleagues, but it is actually an undiagnosed osteodontoidium, which has caused a neurologic deficit after a minor trauma. Axial and sagittal CT images are of great value for diagnosis and planning. And if there are serrated margins, we can suspect trauma. And there are different classifications, but what is important is if there is instability. In some cases, there is not apparent instability or apparent mobility, I must say. So we will see in some management options if it is not moving much. Type of dislocation is mostly anterior, but there are few cases with posterior dislocation, which is having more neurology because the osteodontium goes back. And reducibility is very important part of it. In general, saying in any craniocervical pathology, if it is reducible, then we can just perform a posterior fixation and fusion surgery, no decompression surgery. This is a general rule. This is described by Menezes from US many years before. If it is not reducible, then we must make a fixation, however, perform a good decompression, mostly transoral surgery or anterior decompression. This is a general rule. It is also applicable for basal invagination. It's applicable for many trauma cases and also don't we do. Considerations for surgical treatment. There are many small considerations like degree of direction of instability, reducibility, whether there is significant osteoporosis, whether there is significant cord compression on MR, retrodental reactive lesion on MR, vertebral artery anomaly, and surgical experience and comfort of the surgeon. Actually, it is also an important part of our decision making. So these are the surgical techniques we can apply. Is it good technique C1, C2 posterior wiring? Probably not, because actually I shrink my indications of C1, C2 wiring only to the pediatric patients with odontoid type 2 fractures. I don't do any C1, C2 wiring for any adult patients, because our screwing techniques has evolved too much. There's a case that we had a surgery before in another department two years before, C1, C2 wiring for a male patient, 26 years old, and he had a head injury. And after that had got some tetraparesis. What you see here? The wire is not holding the C2, and there is an increase in an atlantodental interval in flexion. So how come?
No fusion.
Yeah. If you look at the films, we see that this is really not a trauma. This is, in fact, an osteodontoidium. The scenario I have described to you in the beginning, it has happened here. And it's not a good option to have a C1, C2 wiring for an osteodontoidium patient. So what has happened? Atlas has fractured with the wire, multi-filament wire. So we have to operate this patient. Actually, on sagittal CT images, you can see the round borders of the odontoid. This is very apparent that it's because of an osteodontoidium. And probably there was not much grafting at the back. We did a occipital fixation. It was in 2002, 15 years before. If I were today, I wouldn't do that much. I would make it shorter, probably try to place screw on C1 and C2. I have skipped that and then made this long fixation, which is, I think now it is unnecessary to get a long fixation. Another option in osteodontium is transarticular screw fixation. If it is reducible, yes, you can do it. If the vertebral artery anatomy is okay, but there is in general more risk for vertebral artery also, although Joachim does not accept that. Another option is C1, C2 segmental fixation. Less risk of vertebral artery injury. Possible, you can make it with less reduction, and then you can place some reduction forces if you make segmental fixation for osteodontia. So you can even enter the atlanto-axial joint, create it, and then make some destruction, and then place forces to get the C1 body or C1 lateral masses back. There is no body. What about occipital-cervical fixation? We must make it smaller, our indications for occipital-cervical fixation, if there is big deformity, if it is not reduced with the conventional techniques, if there is a necessity for C1 laminectomy, if loose or not secure C1 screw fixation, if the C2 pedicle is too narrow, especially in irreducible cases, you shall use occipital-cervical fixation. What about retro dental pannus formation or hypertrophy? Do you perform every time a trans oral dense resection in those cases? Yeah, actually this is a good case, not my case, but from a publication from Han Chang. This case is showing very well after C1, C2 fixation, a pannus formation at the back of the odontoid has gone after simple fixation. So this is a reaction to instability. Same is happening also with rheumatoid arthritis. If there is not much neurologic deficits, you may leave the patient in this position with fixation. But however, if there is significant neurologic deficits, because it takes time that it heals, you may be doing additional transoral decompression. For safe surgery, we must carefully assess the CT scans. Mastery of surgical techniques skills are really important. For fusion, we must place decorticated layers, good bone graft. And this is the algorithm I propose for osteodontic patients. If there is no symptom at all, no neurology, no significant pain, we can just follow the patient. But if there is neurology or significant pain on the neck, so If it is reducible, just posterior fixation. If it is not reducible, then ventral decompression plus posterior fixation. Occipital atlantal instability, if there is occipital atlantal instability, or if you need to remove SOC1 arch, then you may add occiput to your fixation. This is what I propose for orthodontia. Thank you for listening.